Well, good morning and welcome everyone to this RFF live event titled Carbon Border Measures, Policies to Combat Leakage and Encourage Climate Ambition. I'm Ray Kopp, Senior Fellow and Director of the International Climate Policy Initiative and the Comprehensive Climate Strategies Program at Resources for the Future. I want to thank everybody for joining us today. I know we're probably across 12 different time zones. So it's morning, afternoon, and evening. For those of you who aren't familiar with RFF, we're an independent nonprofit research institution based in Washington, DC. Our mission is to improve environmental, energy, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement. The RFF live event today is the second in a two-part series during COP26, examining border measures. The event last week presented new research focusing on leakage and emissions activity. The event today provides additional research insights, but focuses on proposed border policies in the EU and the US. Our plan for the next hour is to examine this issue through a policy lens rather than a pure research lens. First, we're going to hear from Josh Delbecchi of the European University Institute, and then I will discuss policy proposals in the European Union, and I will discuss proposals in the United States. Next, Keigo Wakimoto from the Research Institute of Innovative Technology for the Earth, and Massimo Tavoni of the RFF CMCC European Institute on Economics and the Environment will break down the impacts of increased ambition on the potential for leakage, both domestic and international. Finally, Carolyn Fisher from RFF and the World Bank and Susie Kerr from the Environmental Defense Fund will provide commentary on these policies. Each of our presenters today is a member of a new organization, the Global Climate Policy Partnership. The partnership links 15 leading economic and policy research institutes working collaboratively to evaluate and propose actionable, politically acceptable policy solutions to help major emitting nations achieve ambitious climate goals efficiently and inclusively. The partnership will be officially launched this January, so be on the lookout for that announcement and upcoming partnership events that will fill the 2022 calendar year. After the presentations and comments, we'll move to a moderated discussion and audience Q&A with our panel. So please feel free to type any questions you might have into the webinar's Q&A box, and we'll be sure to get to some of those questions later in the webinar today. A few housekeeping notes before we get started. This is a public webinar. It's being recorded and will be posted on the RFF website afterwards. Also, if you'd like to join the conversation on Twitter, please use the hashtag RFFLive. With that, let's get started, and I will turn the floor over to Josh.
Thank you, Ray, and it's my pleasure to address here the audience, and I have some slides that I try to share with you, and I hope you see them. So what I would like to do is to introduce the CBAM proposal, the Carbon Border Adjustment Mechanism proposal that the Europeans have put on the table in June of this year. And then I will spend a few words on the process ahead of us. The first element is that this mechanism is mirroring the ETS, the emissions trading system we have in Europe. So importers will be asked to surrender CBAM certificates, and they will be priced on the basis of the price of the EUAs. These are the certificates that are available in the carbon market. And every importer will have to show its actual emissions embedded in the products, and they will need a verification of that. And there is still work going on default values. We can go into that. That's not going to be an easy task, but people are already working on that. A particularity is that for exports, no rebates are being envisaged. So it's purely concentrated on imports. Now, what is the scope? The scope is limited and will start with only six sectors initially, but there is scope for widening up to more sectors. The heavy carbon embedded products are there, such as cement, steel, electricity, aluminum, fertilizers, and some chemicals like nitric acid, ammonia, nitrates of potassium. Some simple goods are included as well. So a limited sectoral scope, but you know, quite important products like cement, steel, and chemicals are there. The emissions scope is that for starting the scheme, the attention goes to scope one, the direct emissions. But there is a lot of debate about scope two, emissions related to electricity and heat. And that may well be considered in a future review that would start already by the end of 2025. Now, there has been a lot of talk about the system of free allocation that is present in the EU ETS. That is going to be gradually phased out over a period of 10 years. And that goes in line with the gradual phase in of the CBAM system. Now, for calculation, the CBAM applies to emissions above the free allocation that is handed out. So it's going for a slow and gradual start in the beginning. Now, on policy crediting, you know, because other countries may show they also are undertaking pricing policies, there the approach is quite restrictive in that sense that only explicit carbon pricing policies in the exporting country will be considered. And the prices that are implemented in these policies are then going to be deducted from the calculation of the CBAM charges. So that is an issue that is certainly for debate, in particular with our friends in the United States, where carbon pricing policies may not see the light of the day in the time frame we are talking about here. So on process, what is the timing that is being envisaged? Well, there will be a transition phase, a pilot phase between 2023 and 2025. And that phase is going to be mostly reporting and data gathering. So no payments will be collected before the end of 2025. And by the end of 2025, there will be a review and possible proposals. As I mentioned, the indirect emissions and other goods could be considered and could be proposed for inclusion. But the full implementation of the CBAM proposal with payments and with revenues is planned to start from the 1st of January of 2026. And the revenues would go to the budget. Of course, there is a lot of debate what to do with the budget, but the proposal on itself is silent on this element. So that means there is a bit of time, there is a window for discussions, and the window is certainly, I think, getting to start it in Glasgow, but there is a lot of discussion in the context of the OECD, possible in the G20 context, whether in that discussion should not take place. We will see what the process is going to give, but the Europeans have made clear they are open for consultation and discussion with other partners. And that's why I welcome this first discussion. And it's going to be an opener, not the end of the discussion, as I would expect. And we really look forward to hear your comments today and also to work further on them. Behind all this is, of course, the idea of whether a carbon club could be developed. You know, the North House idea, you are all very familiar with that idea. Seen from a European perspective, I think that's an attractive proposition, but I think it would only work if we have the major emitters in this such a possible carbon club. That means, or that would mean, the EU, the US, and I would add China, that is starting with an explicit carbon pricing policy, and for which we have had, from a European perspective, a very good cooperation so far. So I will limit my comments to that in the benefit of time and in the benefit of a good discussion. And I really look forward to it. Thank you very much. And over to you, Ray.
Thank you, Josh. That was excellent. Very good. If you would stop sharing your screen. Okay. And I will attempt to share mine, which is that one. So hopefully we see a slide showing. Yes.
Yes, we do.
Excellent. Yeah. So it's interesting that Josh mentioned Carbon Club, because I want to talk a little bit about that. The policies in the US around border carbon adjustments and international trade are far less developed than the EU's, most certainly, but there is a lot of activity ongoing. The first thing I just want to talk about briefly is an agreement that came out of the G20 just 2 weeks ago between the US and the EU. The agreement modifies the tariff structure put in place by the Trump administration, but I don't want to discuss those changes. We can talk a little bit about that if you care during the Q&A. Rather, I want to address the agreement's focus on embedded carbon, as well as concerns about international competition from China and other countries, which are embedded in the same agreement. The statement that was issued from President Biden's office after the conclusion of the G20 reads as follows: "The United States and the EU have today taken joint steps to reestablish historical transatlantic trade flows in steel and aluminum and to strengthen their partnership and address shared challenges in the steel and aluminum sector. As part of that partnership, they intend to negotiate for the first time a global arrangement to address carbon intensity and global overcapacity." I believe it's fair to say that the reference to global overcapacity is code for inexpensive steel and aluminum imports entering the US and the EU markets, primarily from China. But you can see that those concerns about international flows of these commodities, as well as their carbon intensities, are part of this agreement. While the trade and environmental implications of the agreement will be developed over time, the establishment of this working group to share data and develop a common methodology for assessing the embedded emissions of traded steel and aluminum suggests interests, and I would say perhaps intent, in establishing a US and EU aluminum steel and aluminum club, Josh was talking about. Perhaps a club with common emission performance standards that might yet be developed. It's a mechanism by which competitiveness issues, at least within the EU and the US, might be aligned with performance standards associated with reducing emissions from those hard to abate sectors. The agreement does invite other like-minded countries to join in this endeavor to reduce emissions. But again, there's going to be, I think, tension between the issues associated with the carbon intensity of these commodities, along with the international competitiveness of steel globally, which is a particularly difficult problem to tackle. So we can come back and talk more about that during the Q&A. The second part of U.S. climate policy I want to talk about is draft legislation produced by Senator Coons and Representative Peters came out this summer. This legislation, I think, is more aligned with general thinking about carbon tariffs and can be compared to the EU proposal that Josh just discussed. This is, again, not so much a club as it is a fee on imports. Like the EU proposal, the Coons-Peterson targets a few sectors to begin with: fossil fuels, steel, aluminum, iron and cement, and perhaps products that carry more than 50% of their content associated with those particular commodities. Since the US does not have a national carbon price, that is a tax, a fee, an allowance price that could be used to set the tariff, the Coons and Peters proposals propose to measure per unit costs of complying with existing and future domestic US environmental laws, regulations, and policies, and to impose that cost on a per unit fee on imported commodities. So this is going to be a bit of a rather complex undertaking that agencies within the federal government would have to execute. They would have to quantify all of those regulations and policies and the impact they have on the production of particular commodities, and then assign average costs of compliance to the commodities on a per unit basis. And some discussion within the legislation talks about what agencies would do that and how that would get set up. Least developed countries and countries with similar ambitious laws and regulations to limit emissions would be exempt from the fee. This is, obviously something to take care of the important issues about international trade in the global south. But it is a policy that adds a little more content to discussions within the US about how we might move forward with a border carbon adjustment without having a price in place on carbon. I believe it's fair to say that the Coons-Peer proposal legislation is not on track to be passed in the current Congress. It is really a proposal, but it does signal growing concern in the US about international competitiveness impacts of ambitious policies, particularly those policies that would target aluminum, iron, and steel. The proposal also shapes a border measure for an economy that does not have a national carbon price. And we can obviously, as economists, unpack this and understand whether this makes sense from an economic perspective. But it is something that is out there being discussed. So again, like Josh, we will return to both these EU and US policies during the discussion. But again, I think, you know, to stay on time here, I'd like to kind of stop and now turn the floor over to Keigo Akimoto, who Keigo will briefly review some research results related to leakage in the face of ambitious policies. Keigo, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you.
Hey. I will try to stop sharing the screen.
Yeah, please. Okay. Thank you very much. I'd like to talk about the estimations of carbon leakage and the ambitious NDCs and the policy implications shortly. So, yeah. Professor Billy Pizer from RFF kindly coordinates the evaluations of emission reduction efforts of NDCs and the expected carbon leakages and the effects of CBAM by using the two energy economic models developed by EIEE and Wright. This table shows part of the scenarios of preliminary studies on the quantitative and systematic analysis on the impacts of impacts in 2030. Some of the model results had been provided at the research-oriented event organized by RFF last week. We assume Club 1 and Club 2 for analyzing BCA. Club 1 assumes only Europe, and Club 2 assumed Europe, US, and Japan. In order to analyze the carbon leakage, we also assume simply non-club members implement emission reductions with only zero carbon prices, as well as emission reductions pledged in the NDC's targets. Due to the time constraints, I'd like to concentrate on the Club 2 analysis. The negative impacts of NDCs on GDP in Club 2, that is Europe, US, and Japan, are around according to the emissions with global energy economic model, DIAS, which have an international input-output table, carbon prices for NDCs in Europe, US, and Japan are from 190 to $300 per ton CO2. The carbon price in Club 2 we under emission trading is $217 per ton CO2. But the prices in China and India are below $10 per ton CO2. Estimated carbon prices to achieve NDCs differ greatly among countries. Yes. Okay. The negative impacts of NDCs on GDP in Club 2, that is Europe, US, and Japan, are around 2%, but those in energy intensive industries such as iron, steel, chemical, and other EITE sectors are much larger than GDP impacts. In some regions, such as China and India, energy-intensive productions will increase. Carbon leakage are estimated. Under zero carbon prices outside the trap, the leakage rate is reduced by about 1% point, both in CLAB 1 and CLAB 2 cases. When BCL is implemented in all the energy intensive sectors. When BCL is covered only to the iron steel sector, the reduction in the leakage rate is not large. So the international competitiveness of CLAB 2, Europe, US and Japan in iron steel sector will decrease. That means the productions decrease and net imports increase under the ambitious NDCs of the club. BCA will be able to mitigate carbon leakage, but basically it will be more important that all countries achieve their NDC targets and seeking more ambitious targets in the countries with relatively low carbon prices achieving the NDCs. Policy implications from my viewpoints are follows. Estimated carbon prices to achieve the NDCs differ greatly among countries. We estimate considerable carbon leakage under the NDCs from CLAB 2 in energy intensive sectors. Use of a CBAM can mitigate leakage from EITE sectors by a third. The effects of CBAM will vary across countries. Countries who import EITE products will experience larger effects from CBAM than countries who are not large importers. Trade conflicts induced by CBAM can arise and would diminish effective global climate change mitigation. Globally coordinated among emission reduction efforts, such as using carbon prices, may be a better leakage detection mechanism than a CBAM. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Keigo. Max, we turn it over to you.
Thanks. Let me share my screen. So thanks. Thanks, Ari, for organizing this. And let me offer complementary view, not so much on CBAM directly, but possibly with indirect implication for CBAM, trying to review quickly what the flurry of climate neutrality pledges that have happened at the G20 and also in Glasgow. Several countries have announced targets to neutrality, climate or carbon neutrality. There's been new countries with important commitments, such as India, South Africa, Russia, and so forth. And what we did, the quick and dirty exercise of trying to see what are the implications of these recently and newly announced pledges, in addition to those announced even before and already available in the mid-century strategies, is to work out two possibly obvious implications. And the first one is on the climate implications. You see a bunch of scenarios here, but the ones that are consistent with the G20 climate neutrality pledges are the ones in dashed. And what you see, for example, for CO2 or also for all greenhouse gases across the century, is that if you add up those announcements, and if you, depending on what you assume of what the non-G20 countries will do, and that's why we have a green and a red line, so we have two lines, you end up with emissions which are rapidly declining. And the consequences for these emission profiles, depending also what's gonna happen on non-CO2, there's also be an important announcement on methane, will be of temperatures, average temperatures, which are roughly compliant with the Paris Agreement, so between 1.5 and 2 degrees. A similar announcement was made also by the International Energy Agency just the other day. And it just comes out relatively simply, I would say, from the math of adding up the neutralities, which overall align relatively well, if not perfectly, with the goal of the Paris Agreement and the overall neutrality objectives. Now, the question, of course, is that what happens then, if, even if announcements are made, what extent we need shorter term actions on CO2 emission reductions and policies need to accompany these large transitions. And what we know also in terms of credibility of and shorter term needs of these scenarios, also from the scenario literature, is that neutrality objectives must be accompanied by rapid emission reductions already this decade. We are looking, each dot here is a different scenario. And what we are seeing is that significant emission reductions, possibly up to 50% emission reductions globally, must be done throughout the next decade if we want to be consistent with neutralities around mid-century. Later dates, of course, can lead to lower initial efforts. And in some cases, one might also wait a little bit more and peak emissions later in the decade and still try to achieve neutrality objectives. But those neutrality targets would move later in the century. And only few scenarios can achieve neutrality without a very significant effort already right now. So the vast majority of dots assumes that essentially emissions have to peak where we are right now and cannot keep growing furthermore for any additional year. Now, the implications of these emission reductions efforts can be quantified. There are many metrics. Carbon pricing is obviously one, which depends very much on many assumptions, including technological change. But from a quick look at the carbon price, average carbon price in the countries, the G20 countries, which committed to neutrality, we are seeing carbon prices which are quite high. Average for this decade, we are talking about possibly above 100, possibly to 200 euros per ton of CO2. For those countries who have committed to neutrality, that's about an average. There's variation between the different countries committed to neutrality, obviously, and there's even a larger variation between the countries who committed to neutrality and the countries who didn't. Obviously, the large price discrepancy might indeed create issues of competitiveness, besides other issues as well. And this is higher than the typical carbon price that you would need to achieve 2 degrees in a relatively orderly international way, with just single carbon price across the world, which would have a carbon price which would be significantly lower. But at the same time, a lower carbon price would be felt equally by all countries and would also have equity repercussions, which would be smaller if we have mostly industrialized countries committing to earlier climate neutrality pledges. But that would need a higher carbon price, certainly higher than what we see today. And possibly that carbon price might be reduced by technological progress, as has happened in the past and may well happen in the future. But what we see from these first results is that a significant price would be needed and to achieve neutrality pledges, and there might be price differentials which are significant, which might lead also to what Keigo also showed in previous slides, to possible leakage effects. So I stop here, Ray, and I'll turn it back to you.
Oh, great, thanks, Max. So far we've heard a little bit about EU and US policies. We've heard some research results, some modeling results. I think now it's time to turn over to get more policy specific and some criticisms perhaps of these policy proposals going forward. Let's start with Carolyn Fisher, who is a senior fellow at Resources for the Future and also at the World Bank. So Carolyn, the floor is yours.
Thanks. I'm just going to share a couple of slides. That's me. To sort of tie together and ground the border adjustment policies and sort of what the ideas are behind it. So really, when you think about climate policies, they impose two kinds of cost increases on firms. So if we think of this as marginal abatement costs or the incremental cost of increasing abatement, there are two components. So when you have a price-based policy or any policy, you have direct abatement costs. So these are sort of the compliance costs, trying to reduce emissions by changing processes, technologies, et cetera. So both price and non-price policies have these kind of direct abatement costs, but then only price-based policies have what we'll call embodied emissions costs. And this is really what the carbon border adjustment mechanism in the EU is trying to get at, because firms have to buy allowances, or in the case of a carbon tax, they'd have to pay carbon taxes on all of their remaining emissions that they don't abate. By contrast, standards effectively exempt firms from these embodied carbon costs, and free allocation does as well. So free allocation would be reducing sort of the compliance costs for firms by reducing their liability for these embodied carbon costs. Now the challenge for using free allocation to keep cost increases down is that at really deep decarbonization, these direct abatement costs become a much bigger carbon cost component. And it gets more difficult for free allocation to offset these. So if you think of the EU case, looking forward, trying to get to net zero, there are very few allowances remaining to allocate for free to compensate firms for large cost differentials. And so you see, this is what the US is wrestling with in thinking about maybe trying to set some standards, rigorous standards for emissions intensive industries without a price-based mechanism. They still might have costs. The challenge is offsetting this and staying within WTO agreements and responsibilities, where you're not supposed to subsidize firms, and you've agreed to lower tariffs, and you have no carbon price to base the tariff adjustment. At least in the case of the EU, you have a price, and you can say, so domestic firms may not actually have to pay very much embodied carbon costs because they're clean, but they would have to if they hadn't reduced. And so that's the price that you're asking for an emission. So I think it's a big challenge for the US in thinking ahead towards a non-pricing system of how they would impose tariffs that are WTO compatible with WTO obligations. On the other hand, it's an interesting idea to think about more sector-based agreements as a way of getting around this. And finally, I just want to point out that this sort of competitiveness is the most politically challenging aspect of leakage. So competitiveness-related leakage is sort of the shifting of economic activity to avoid these extra carbon costs. But it's not the only channel for leakage. There's also a lot of leakage that we see going on in these models. So why the border adjustment mechanisms don't really succeed in reducing leakage a whole lot is because you also have the energy market channel. So as ambitious countries reduce their demand for fossil fuels, that frees more supply up for the rest of the world, prices fall, and then it becomes cheaper for the rest of the world to become more carbon intensive and consume fossil fuels. But finally, there's also potentially negative leakage. So if these policies in ambitious countries can create and induce innovation and new technologies, clean technologies, make those cheaper and make those the global standard for production in energy intensive industries, and this can diffuse around the world, then that's a potential for negative leakage. So I think, politically, the competitiveness channel is the most important one to get at. And so thinking of mechanisms that adhere to our trade obligations and also to our UNFCCC common but differentiated responsibilities agreements, and that can negotiate in a negotiated way and consistent way bring down carbon emissions in these key sectors. That's really the challenge. Let me stop there.
Thanks, Carolyn. Excellent. Now we'll turn to Susie Kerr, who is the chief economist at the Environmental Defense Fund. Susie, the floor is yours.
Kia ora, Tato, and thank you for this opportunity. I'm going to focus on a different aspect of the challenge, which is looking at it from the point of view of developing countries. So particularly looking at the equity implications that can arise from these sorts of mechanisms. So they can lead to a transfer of resources from developing countries to richer countries, or they can penalize those who are struggling to be clean rather than helping them in the process of transition and mitigation. And this is particularly relevant where incentives to mitigate or lack of incentives are not the only barrier to mitigation. So what are the solutions? One is the possibility that you simply exempt the poorest countries and that avoids the equity issue, but it doesn't avoid the leakage problem. And it doesn't create the incentive for those countries to accelerate their transition. So the alternative, which I want to sort of flag today, is shifting from penalties towards emissions for emissions to rewards for emission reductions. So looking at how this operates, we have similar to Carolyn's, but a much simpler. We have the, for example, EU MAC for producing cement. And in this very simple picture, the cement used in the EU would all be produced in the EU because the purple is the MAC for the non-EU countries. So when you have the regulation, as you do now, you have the EU emissions trading system, but you also have other forms of regulation that increases the costs of the cement production in the EU. It doesn't affect the non-EU and you get the leakage problem. So if you use a CBAM to address that, then what you're essentially doing is raising the purple line, so the MAC, the marginal abatement cost curve for the non-EU countries, by the amount of regulation and the remaining price they have to pay under the CBAM. And you remove, in my very simple picture, you completely remove the leakage problem. So that's one solution. But you can mimic this essentially by using some positive incentives. So one example of this is what we call a climate action team or a CAT, where there's a crediting baseline for the country set below the country. This is the developing country's BA. So it's at an ambitious level of reductions, but not at the same level of reductions that would be expected somewhere like the EU or the US. And then the rewards are calculated by comparing monitored emissions with that crediting baseline. And what I've drawn here is applied at a national economy-wide level, but it could also be applied at a sectoral level. There are some disadvantages of that, but the same mechanism would apply. And what that does is it creates an opportunity cost at the country level. So the credit that is paid, or the ITMO payment, if it's under Article 6.2, is the difference between national emissions and the crediting baseline times the price that is agreed in the agreement. And then the country has an incentive to try to get cement emissions to fall in the country because the country gets rewarded for that reduction and can use those anticipated rewards to actually mobilize the mitigation. So in a very simple picture, essentially you end up with exactly the same thing as you would in a CBAM, except that the rewards are going to the developing country. And this only applies, of course, if the country that is receiving the developing country actually applies these incentives onto their sector. So you would want to, if you're worried about leakage, you want to make sure that the developing country actually does implement policies on the sectors you're focused about leakage from. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Susie. So we will let me thank everybody actually for these wonderful presentations, and we'll kind of open the floor now for some Q&A. We know that Max has to leave a little early, and I have one question directly from Max, so I think I'll just pose it to him now. Max, what methodology have you used to forecast carbon emissions to 2030?
So we took all the NDCs, which are already been committed to for 2030. So those are the starting point. And then on top of that, we added the mid-century strategies for the countries that committed and the climate neutrality strategies announced at the at the G20 meeting in Rome. We also added on top the methane reductions announced in Glasgow. And then we fed these pledges and emission profiles and emission targets or neutrality targets into an integrated assessment model and ran it throughout. And the results you saw were for climatic implications of all these bunch of scenarios. Of course, we had to make assumptions. Those countries which did not commit to a mid-century strategy or to a neutrality timing, and those we did two assumptions about convergence in pricing of implicit pricing of CO2 towards the other countries, or an extrapolation of the pledges from 2020 onwards. That result in two different lines, which I showed in the first slide, which two different climatic implications, but not radically different in terms of temperature.
Thanks, Max. So Josh, a question to you. Why is there no export rebate in the EU CBAM? Is it a legal or a policy issue? And does this not result in decreased competitiveness in the EU?
Okay, well, I think it's rather a legal issue. I think, the strong EU tradition is multilateral, and the strong attachment to the WTO has been very much in the back of the mind of the people designing this. So that is certainly a reason. And now some companies are asking for export rebates, but that box, the Commission was not willing to open. And that is, I think, the reason. If that box would have been opened, the debate with the WTO would have become even more complicated. It's a valid question. It's going to be part of the discussion, but it is not present, very actively present in the European debate. It's, the concentration goes to the imports, and that is where 95% of the attention is going. I know in the United States, the debates of the past were, but somewhat different, but that is not reflecting the European debate, I would say.
I see. Thanks, Charles. Another quick question here. Is the free allocation in 2025 onward based on the emissions intensity in the current year? That is, 2025, or is it based on like 2007, 2008 values?
Oh, that's a complicated question. It is based on 2007, 2009 values, but there is a gradual correction for that reality. So it is not 2025, but it's something hanging in between. And that is being done according to several parameters. I would say there is a correction for technological progress, but not to the current state of the art technological progress, if you see what I mean. So it's somewhere hanging in between. We can dig it out, but it depends on which sector we are talking about. It's a complicated thing because free allocation is complicated on itself to negotiate with companies. We want to get away from it. We want to update technological progress, but it's not an easy process to do so. So that's why, according to the different sectors, the reality is hanging in between the 2007-2009 and the current state of the art technology.
If any of the other panelists want to weigh in on any of these questions associated with some of the stuff that seems a little a little specific, please please raise your hand and jump in. I do want to turn one to we have a question for a self-identified political scientist, which I think is a quite good question. Is talking a little bit about the difficulty of dealing with China and all of these measures. In particular, if we think we're moving towards some club arrangements, particularly around these hard to abate sectors, which we know have a lot of cost associated with it, a lot of competitiveness issues, What strategies are available to induce China and perhaps even India to join the club? Does anybody want to tackle that?
If I may just make an opening remark, I think as it stands now, the proposal is quite friendly to what is happening in China. But what is the Chinese problem? It is coal. So the indirect emissions related to electricity use and heat are not yet incorporated into the scheme. And that pressure is going to come. So dealing with China is going to be very different ballgame as soon as the indirect emissions are going to be included. That happens for steel, but even more so for aluminum, for fertilizer and other, you know, very electricity intensive products. And that is where the scheme as it is now is hanging in between and needs much more elaboration, I think, to investigate that. The preliminary elements that we, analysis that we have been doing is that it is hitting more the immediate trading partners of Europe. It is hitting first Russia, second Turkey, and other Middle East countries. And it is only to the extent that steel comes into the game, that China is coming into the game, and the indirect emissions related to heat and electricity, where also aluminum and other products would come into the game. But I think, and we see it already in the diplomatic reactions, Turkey is already talking now, has ratified the Paris Agreement because of the CBAM, and both in Turkey and in Russia, there are the first thoughts on establishing a carbon market, because they want to take the rent first before it is taken off by their trade with the EU. So the geopolitical perspective for Europe is quite diversified. It is the neighbors, in particular Russia, it is China, it is the United States.
Any other panelists want to comment on that, on the geopolitics of cheap imported steel?
I think it's important to remember that, so the EU has tried to be very careful to design a border adjustment mechanism as consistent as possible with WTO obligations. It's important to remember that countries like China do have the option to dispute border adjustment mechanisms or carbon tariffs that they feel do not adhere to WTO rules. And so there is the possibility of, a continued maybe tariff war if done improperly and done without consultation. So I think that is another danger of trying to be a little too creative of going ahead with carbon tariffs in the absence of a domestic carbon pricing mechanism. So engaging China and India in sort of club negotiations, maybe and also maybe minimum carbon pricing agreement. So there's talk about in the G20 about trying to agree to sort of minimum carbon pricing. So anything you can do to reduce these cost discrepancies, either through sectoral agreements or through broader carbon pricing, is going to hopefully limit the need for resorting to trade measures like border carbon adjustments in order to address these competitiveness issues.
Right, there was a comment that Kago made early on. It's, the closer you bring the competitors in line with their abatement costs, the better off you're going to be. There was a question just came up here, which is interesting. Talking about the EU CBAM, which is based on explicit carbon prices. And then the US Coons-Peters proposal, which is based on implicit costs of complying with those regulations. And the question is, how can this be reconciled? I might say maybe it can't be reconciled, but does anybody have any comment on whether these two policies can coexist amicably within a global setting?
Perhaps one quick reaction. I think calculation, the embedded costs of carbon and other things, is going to be an absolute nightmare. You know, when we were starting in the EU with the ETS, you know, there was a lot of talk about the cost of embedded carbon. It has always been there, but the variations that are there in the estimates are huge. And I think that is going to be a very important problem. Also coming back to the question that was raised by Carolyn and you, Ray, I think there is a quite distinction between the case of India and China. China is developing a nationwide carbon market, and the industrial products that are mentioned are in the scope already of the legislator in China. So if they want to go quick, they can go quick. Very different in India. I think it's a completely different context where carbon markets are not taking off for, you know, decades to come, I would say, if I follow the debate there. But taking up Caroline's argument, I think we should not think about the same price, but about a price span within which we can handle the differences in between the carbon costs embedded in the products of our different countries. So far, the Europeans have been living with 60 euros per ton of carbon, and the ceiling has not come down on the European economy. So there is a span between zero and 60 euros, if I would say. Of course, there is the caveat of the free allocation, et cetera, et cetera. But if I look at Massimo's kind forecast, if he would go to 100 euros, 200 euros per ton of carbon, then we are in a completely different ballgame. So let's think about the price span that our system can handle. That could perhaps make things a little bit easier for economists to think through concepts.
Right, thanks, Josh. A question going back again to embedded emissions. The question is, you know, can you discuss how challenging it will be to calculate embedded emissions? And will you be doing that at a facility level, at a country level, at a company level? How will that be done? I know within the EU-US agreement, setting up this working group to thinking about embedded emissions. I'm anxious to see how that plays out and whether other countries get a chance to participate in that going forward. I know Japan has thought a lot about how they're going to calculate embedded emissions within their particular products. I think the Koreans are working on that as well. But I mean, Josh, have you heard anything more about setting up that working group within the EU? Because there's this kind of radio silence here on this side of the Atlantic about how that would get set up.
Well, the silence is also at the side of our side of the Atlantic by way of speaking. And I also note there is quite some silence at the COP26. I would have anticipated before that the CBAM discussion would have been much more active at the COP. It hasn't so far. It has been dominating. It has not been dominating the debates in the corridors. Tomorrow, there is an official event by the EU where, you know, the CBAM is going to be discussed. Let's wait and see. But, you know, I think, you know, we are all looking forward to the operational development of this kind of working group. That's going to be a very important test for both of us, or in fact, both sides of the Atlantic, to hammer things out.
Thanks. A question to both Susie and to Carolyn. It's not a question that's been posed by the audience, but I'm thinking to myself here. And that is around these carbon clubs. Susie's point, I think, is a good one, and that is, can we expand the club by allowing investment and technology to flow to other partners within the lesser developed countries? And can that sit and can that coexist with a club that is just establishing performance standards across these hard to abate sectors? And in particular, where are the revenue sources? Are there revenue sources? I mean, if everybody was in a cap and trade program and we had, you know, private investment moving to kind of buy those allowances, I can imagine how that worked. But in a mechanism where we don't necessarily have that, is there ways for private investment to flow to help these countries improve the performance of their hard to abate sectors and be part of these clubs? Any comments on that, Susie? This is going to maybe one to you.
Yeah, I think that's totally the way to think about this, that by creating these agreements with poorer countries, with developing countries, we can help them, encourage them to join the clubs, or make it easy for them to join the clubs, particularly if there is a band of prices, as has been discussed, so that they don't have to instantly leap to the $60 a ton or $150 a ton sort of levels. And you could come into that club through something like a CAT agreement, maybe supplemented by something that does require that in your EITE sectors, your trade exposed sectors, that you have specific regulatory standards in those as well, so that you are addressing leakage. Sorry, there was another part of your question.
I was just talking about the financing flows that I think, you know.
Right, the financing flows. So yeah, so the simplest model is that the buyer country, or the country that is paying for that country to join the club, or who is essentially providing the incentive for them to join. The simplest example is that they can allow their participants in their emissions trading system to purchase units out of an agreement like that. It doesn't have to be linked ETSs, but if there are units generated from the country that is selling, the host country, then they are entitled to buy those super high quality units and use it in their ETS. That means that they're mobilized to provide the payment funding. But of course, the real finance comes from the capital markets, the finance to actually build the clean infrastructure, et cetera. And that has to be motivated by more favorable investment conditions in the host country, be partly because they've got these rewards. So they have the ability to offer incentives or to de-risk investments and so on.
Thanks, Susie. Carol, anything you want to add to that?
Yeah. I think it's really important to remember that the point isn't just to limit the carbon cost discrepancies. The point is to encourage decarbonization. So border carbon adjustment on its own is pretty limited because it's only going to apply to imports. So it's not clear how much leverage, say, the EU would have over China just, you know, applying some carbon cost on the, you know, product that it imports, the emissions intensive products it imports from China. That's a relatively small share of what China or any country does. So what's interesting about Susie's idea is that this is, you know, so whereas a border adjustment typically goes on the product as the firm that has to demonstrate compliance, this would be an agreement with countries. So if you're getting a sectoral agreement, these countries are agreeing to apply standards to their entire sectors. So you have potentially a much bigger lever for decarbonization there, but it's gonna have to go hand in hand with technology transfer and incentives for those countries. But then you have, I think, a much greater potential to actually solve this this knot of trying to decarbonize equitably these sectors around the world.
Right, if I may come in. I think on Susie's point, I think we have to distinguish between real developing countries and emerging economies. I think that is the new world we are living in. And so I think the CBAM proposal is targeted at the G20 countries, basically. The real developing countries, there's going to be a lot of understanding to support them in terms of technology, in terms of capital and soft capital and grants and whatever. I think, some of us were surprised that was not incorporated into the CBAM proposal that is now on the table. But, you know, it would go against the principles of WTO and against the Commission wanted to be very loyal to the principles of the WTO. A quick comment on sectoral agreements. They look fine, but let's not forget that in the context of the World Business Council on Sustainable Development, in particular on cement and on steel, there were 4 years efforts to harmonize, you know, the embedded carbon or technology standards or whatever, because they saw the problem coming. And this all failed. So there is going to be a strong governmental push going to be necessary to hammer out this kind of implicit standards that are going to be used, otherwise it's never going to work. And that happens for a bilateral agreement or a bilateral sectoral agreement, or as much for a carbon club agreement, or even for a CBAM. You know, I think the way the Europeans have been doing that is to put the onus on the importers to prove what they are doing, and on third-party verification to correct the figures that are going to be put forward.
Thanks, Josh. Well, we've reached the end of our session. So at this point, I want to bring this event to a close by thanking you all for joining us today and for your thoughtful questions provided to the panelists. For those of you that are at COP26, I hope it's going well this afternoon. Be sure to check out the recording of our first event on border measures from November 3rd of last week. That can be viewed on the RFF website at rff.org/events. And this event can be rewatched in full again on the RFF website under events, where you can find out more about subscribing to our content and supporting resources for the future. Finally, thanks very much to our speakers for their insights and their expertise, and to the audience for all of your comments. With that, I will close this and have a great day. Thank you very much.